Hello, everybody, and thanks for attending our Introduction to Implementation Practice in Science webinar. My name is Genevieve Creighton, and I'm Manager for Knowledge Translation at the Michael Smith Foundation for Health Research. So, this webinar is designed to provide a primer to implementation practice in science for those of you who are interested in applying for the inaugural and very exciting implementation science team program. It's also designed to increase capacity for implementation science across the province, so we welcome all of you who have joined us. For those who are interested in learning more, we have resources and a more fulsome description on our webpage of this program. So a recording of this webinar will be made available. So for those who were not able to make it, feel free to pass that information on. After the webinar, evaluation will pop up, and we really encourage you to fill that out as it will inform our future education and training processes. So there will be another webinar for the competition, the Implementation Science Team Awards, on April 27th. So keep that in mind if you're in that program.
I'm sorry, February 27th.
So I just want to run over some of our learning objectives for today. Looking at the registration list, I see people with a great deal of experience in implementation science and practice. So just a heads up, this is designed to be a beginner level webinar, and we have more advanced level resources on our website under KT Resources. So today we're going to do a very brief flyover of knowledge translation and note where implementation fits within KT, but the bulk of our time will be spent on the strategies, models, theories, and tools in implementation practice. So implementation science, as we'll cover later, is the study of the practice of implementation. So it's more important to be clear about what we are actually aiming to study. So as we go through the implementation practice, have your eye on how you might go about studying the various elements that are addressed. And the final component of the webinar will focus on implementation science, and we'll include some tips about what you might want to include in an implementation science application. So let's get started with some of the basics of KT. So as you probably know, there are many, many terms that fall under the umbrella of knowledge translation. So there was a study done in 2010 by McKibben, who found over 125 terms in a body of health literature alone that represent KT. So this is not to say that there are not conceptual differences between these terms, but many of the aims and activities are encompassed that are similar. As you know, there are probably different terms that are used in different disciplines. The Social Science and Humanities Research Council calls this set of activities knowledge mobilization, but KT and KM are largely the same. So just to briefly go over a definition, the purpose of knowledge translation is to take findings from research, inform them with real-world context, spread and implement them widely to inform effective policies, practices, and programs, and do it in partnership with researchers and research users. The idea being that if research users are involved in the research process, the results will be more relevant and useful to them, so they'll be more likely to use them. So we use the CIHR definition of KT, like many organizations across the country, which is the dynamic and iterative process that includes synthesis, dissemination, exchange, and ethically sound application of knowledge to improve health services products and strengthen the healthcare system. And of course, this takes place in a complex system of interaction. So why KT? One of the reasons for the urgency of doing knowledge translation is that infamous 17-year gap. In the paper you see referenced on this slide, researchers found that without KT strategies, it takes an average of 17 years for research to make it into policy and practice. So language is important. Too often, KT and implementation are spoken about as though they were the same. As you see on the left, KT is a set of activities that includes knowledge synthesis, sharing, dissemination to inform for future research. Implementation is a KT goal for the type of research evidence that has instrumental use and is ethically ready for application and scale up. So now that we've covered a little bit about KT, and we have lots more resources if you're interested in delving in further, we're going to turn to implementation practice. So So just to return to the paper you saw referenced previously, well, admittedly, the paper that Ballas and Boren wrote is 18 years old, and to my knowledge hasn't been replicated. There's still plenty of evidence that most programs to address gaps in patient care are still not evidence-based, being implemented as intended, being evaluated rigorously, or being sustained. And that means that many patients don't get the treatments that are shown to be effective, and many patients get unneeded or potentially harmful treatments, and many, many patients don't get enough information to make decisions. So McGlynn and colleagues observed that patients in the U.S. received only 50% of recommended care, and of course that quality varied by medical conditions. So 79% of recommended care for senile cataracts, down to 11% of recommended care for alcohol dependence. An interesting study done in Ontario showed that glucose self-testing by older patients with diabetes on oral agents was identified in systematic reviews to be unnecessary and potentially harmful. However, coverage of glucose test strips that you see on many ads continues in many provinces, which costs Ontario alone $100 million a year. So returning to the CIHR definition, a component of KT is application of knowledge, or what we are calling implementation. So while not all evidence is ready or appropriate to be translated into practice and policy, some is, and that's where the process of implementation occurs. And I want to go over the definitions that we have listed in our program guidelines. We consulted widely about the definitions that sat well with most people, and these are the two that we found. So implementation, according to the NIH, is the use of strategies to adopt and integrate evidence-based health interventions and change practice patterns within specific settings. So implementation focuses on taking interventions that are found to be effective using methodologically rigorous designs under real-world conditions and integrating them into practice settings, so not only in this healthcare sector, using deliberate strategies and processes. So the key word is deliberate methods, strategies, and processes. In the next few slides, we'll talk about some of these strategies and processes and where they might be situated in the process of implementation. Implementation science is a scientific study of methods and tools that promote the systematic uptake of research findings and other evidence-based practices into routine practice and policy, and hence to improve population health and/or the quality and effectiveness of healthcare services. So to break that down, implementation science is a study of implementation practice. It's a study of the processes that a team engages in when delivering or adapting interventions to settings different from the ones in which they are originally developed for. It looks at what it works to bring about change, how specific health interventions can better adapt it to different regions or cultures or genders or conditions, and how the impact of interventions can be scaled up. So we'll return to the definition of implementation science, but first it's important to get on the same page in terms of what we understand implementation practice to be. As I said, implementation practice falls under the umbrella of KT and can occur when evidence has been deemed ready to be put into practice or policy. So there's many models about how to think about and do knowledge translation and implementation, and they're generally based conceptually on change theory or participatory action theory. Some models that you may have heard of are Rogers' Diffusion of Innovation and subsequent work by Tricia Greenhall, the Promoting Action on Research Implications in Health Services, or the Paris Framework that was developed by Allison Kitson, the National Implementation Research Network by Blaise and Fixon, and you can find all these resources on our webpage. And then finally, the Knowledge to Action model that was developed by Ian Graham and colleagues while he was at CIHR. So all of these have the same or similar elements. All are about processes, all are not recipes. We're going to focus today on the K2A model as a way to walk through the process of implementation practice, because it's a way of capturing all its stages, and it's probably the one that's most recognizable. So let's start with a funnel in the middle of the K2A cycle. And this section is to illustrate that knowledge must be distilled before it is applied. So knowledge inquiry is that first-generation knowledge, so the broad-based primary studies or the pilot research or information. And as it's distilled, it becomes knowledge synthesis. So those are the methodologies for determining what we know in a given area or field and what the knowledge gaps are. So this would be the systematic reviews or the scoping reviews. And then further distilled are the knowledge tools or products. So this is the refined knowledge for decision making. So that might include guidelines or decision aids or algorithms. This is your ideal practice. It is evidence informed, the result of synthesized knowledge. So this may be vaccines, practice guidelines for low back pain, mental health interventions for depression in young people. Now, before we move from the discussion of the knowledge cycle, I want to point out that knowledge creation can happen at any part of the K2A cycle or the process of implementation. So as we know, knowledge is dynamic rather than stable. New research can come to light at any time in the implementation process. Different research might become relevant, but also knowledge does not just emerge from the published literature. As many of us know, it's also important to acknowledge that tacit knowledge or local knowledge are equally important to integrate and can emerge as a byproduct in the process of implementation. What we know from research may be trumped by what we know from experience, and both are valid. So the outer circle is the process for putting your ideal practice into action, and the double arrows are there to indicate that there is considerable back and forth as there's learning at all stages. So you may need to go back and rethink earlier phases at any time. The K2A cycle is designed to deliberately cause change. So let's begin at the bottom. What's the problem? So for example, the inappropriate prescribing of antibiotics by physicians. What is the gap between what you know about the problem and what everyone else does? In a best-case scenario, you've engaged your knowledge users at the initial process of knowledge creation, but if you haven't, you must engage your knowledge users at this stage. You may, as a researcher, have your ideal practice, but now you have to ensure that this is ideal from the perspective of those who will benefit from it, those who will be on the front lines implementing it, and those who may be inconvenienced by your ideal practice. This is the time where you can inform your research team, which must be a combination of researchers and knowledge users. Now, I think this is a great example. My colleague Donna Angus always brings this up, and she talks about CanSolve, which is a spore network on kidney disease that involved patients. And it took them a whole year to get through this stage because they had needed to agree on research questions because the questions that the researchers wanted to explore were of no interest to the patients. So this process of engagement, consultation, working together to identify the problem and the knowledge and the informed intervention is of vital importance. So in the next stage, we work to adapt the knowledge to the local setting. So this is determined. This is where we determine what's relevant and feasible from one setting to another. So urban to rural, developed to developing country, province to province,
one population to another.
In this stage, we focus on knowing the context so that knowledge might be best suited. There are many frameworks for systematically analyzing the context in which knowledge will be implemented. The Consolidated Framework for the Implementation Research, or CFIR, by Dan Schroeder, is one of the most commonly used. So the first two stages of this framework in particular can help to ensure that you are capturing several elements of the context. The CFIR uses language that is organization-specific, but it can also be adapted to look in at community-based or other settings for implementation. So I want to highlight that there is considerable overlap between the elements that are listed here, so don't worry too much about coming to an agreement about what encompasses what. What is important is that each area is adequately explored. So if we start from the inner setting, we're looking at the structure. So what's the structure of the organization? And what's the structure of the department in your organization? You want to look at networks and communication. What are the group dynamics in an organization? As you know, every organization has its own culture, different communication styles. Each organization has the values and priorities that it prioritizes. And the next two sections, implementation climate and readiness, are really about that tension for change. So when you look at within the organization, do people have a vested interest in the project that you're introducing? What is the history? Have there previously been conflict about whether or not the project or the priority should be introduced? Is new learning encouraged within a climate? Also, who's in charge in your organization? What kind of leader are they? Do they support new learning? Do people have autonomy to make decisions? Are there resources in place to support the implementation? And then we can move to the outer setting, and that really focuses on who are the patients and beneficiaries' needs and preferences. What do they want? Do they think that your ideal practice or new innovation is important? How is that how is the organization connected to the other groups? Is it a rural health clinic that is also involved with the social work and other community services, or is it more isolated? Is there peer pressure to implement? If so, from where? Is it from on high? Is it from the staff level? Are there external policies driving the project? And what are people's perceptions of these policies? So you can use a variety of different methods of data collection. So you can collect this data through interviewing, focus group, survey, and observation. But what's important is that you have a way of structuring your findings and a way of presenting this information as a way of determining whether or not your context is ready for change. So the next two steps in the knowledge cycle are relevant to assessing the barriers to knowledge use and selecting and tailoring and implementing interventions. They're tightly linked and can be considered in tandem. And just to introduce one more model, I've always found this one really helpful to understand the implementation and the selection of strategies. So if you look on the left, you see that we have our evidence-informed ideal practice. So this is derived from the knowledge funnel. And you are going to implement this ideal practice by using evidence-informed implementation strategies. So that double red arrow represents the theories of behavior change. What are the barriers to change, and what psychological theories will be employed to facilitate individual and system change? And then, of course, the implementation strategies. Those are the activities designed to move the intervention forward. So let's go over some implementation strategies. So implementation strategies are the methods or techniques used to enhance the adoption of the practice. So the strategies that you use will come by different names, such as innovations or behavior change or interventions. And the key point I want to highlight here is that implementation strategies should be evidence-based, so proven to work to bring about change. And there are many, many evidence-based implementation strategies available to choose from. Here's one from Sharon Strauss at the KT team at St. Mike's that put together a great resource that lists the number of interventions that are evidence-based and categorizes them according to the audience for whom they could be directed. So they list mass media, doing workshops, creating a collaborative or community practice, using train-the-trainer strategies, conducting educational meetings, altering financial arrangements, using peer mentorship, a change to institutional policy. Some of you may have heard of CADIF's RX for Change, which is a searchable database on current research evidence about intervention strategies to change behavior. And all of these resources will be posted on our website. So how do we go about picking what implementation strategies we are going to use to implement our interventions? We start by determining the barriers and facilitators to knowledge use. That analysis of context for knowledge use that you saw in the CIFR model will help to guide your assessment of the potential barriers and facilitators. Barriers and facilitators to implementing knowledge use is something that many of us understand because of our day-to-day work within healthcare scenarios and research. And it's perhaps the most well-understood process of implementation practice. And a fun fact that I learned a few months ago was that the Journal of Implementation Science isn't taking any more articles on this topic because they feel it's been adequately covered. But that said, it's a very vital step. So the analysis of barriers and facilitators will guide the implementation strategies that you select and the theory of change that you use to implement them. It's a big piece of work. Is it a lack of resources? Is it habit? Is it lack of money or facilitators such as strong opinion leaders? And as you know, many complex interventions can require identifying barriers and facilitators for a variety of stakeholders as they exist in the system, organization, or individual level. So you need to go through and think about the barriers and facilitators for every group and then break them down if there are subgroups. So you pick the implementation strategies you think will best address the barriers and contexts. Okay, so this doesn't seem clear if there's many models and no empirical examples yet. Don't worry, we're going to walk through an example in a few minutes. So back to this model. And that double red arrow that you see theory that connects the ideal practice with the implementation strategy. So these are the theories of behavior change. So improving implementation of evidence-based practice by healthcare workers depends on changing multiple behaviors of multiple types of people. As you know, behavior change is not easy. I've tried to change my own behaviors and it's taken me months or I've never done it. But what we know is it's more effective if implementation strategies are based on evidence-based principles of behavior change. So designing an implementation strategy on the basis of practitioner or researcher intuition, we'll just try this because I think it might work, precludes the possibility of understanding that behavior change process. Behavior change interventions are informed by theory, are more effective than those that are not. So the theoretical domains are proposed to be a mediator of behavior change. As we just discussed, an understanding of barriers to change can be useful in defining what theoretical domain will be used to guide in implementation strategies. And this is where you can dust off that psychology degree that you never thought you used and pull it out. And so in the literature, 12 theoretical domain frameworks, or TDFs, have been defined. So I'm showing you six here, but there are 12 that cover the main factors influencing behavior change. So the first step is developing a theory-informed implementation intervention, is defining who needs to do what differently. The second step is choosing a theoretical domain framework that you think will address these barriers. Is the barrier to lack of knowledge use due to a lack of knowledge, or is it a lack of influence? So you're going to pick those based on the framework that aligns with those barriers. And then the third step, of course, is to choose techniques for implementation based on the theoretical domain that you've chosen. So if you're new to theoretical domains, you might want to take a look at this article, which outlines the 12 validated theories for behavior change. So because health problems are always complex with multiple stakeholders and issues, there's rarely only one TDF used in an implementation intervention. So let's look at a study done by Khan et al. On addressing the issue of smoking in young people as a way of further understanding this. So their study showed that aside from the fact that nicotine is addictive, there are actually four other barriers that stood in the way of youth quitting smoking. So those barriers were that their friends smoke. They have an established routine or habit of smoking in certain times and places. They're not aware of the toll that it is taking on their body and that people smoke in their environment. So those are the barriers. This is why youth don't quit smoking. And so what they were able to do is to map on the theoretical domain frameworks to each barrier and come up with an implementation strategy. So their friends smoke. They chose the theoretical domain framework of social influence and chose an implementation strategy of getting non-smoker peer support. They have an established routine, so they map that onto behavioral regulation, and we're able to track when and where you smoke and do something else instead, so chewing gum. They're not aware of the toll it's taking on their body, so that not me attitude. So this mapped onto positive reinforcement and encouraging youth to take up activities such as exercising your lungs. Other people smoking in their environment, so that mapped onto environmental factors or social norms. And for this, they adopted a system-wide approach of implementing smoke-free policies. So as you can see, the purple arrows are the theoretical domains, and the theoretical domains influence the choice of implementation strategies. So as you can see, the implementation is complex, and there's constant back and forth between the steps. Knowledge creation is happening at each step as you find out more about the context. And the barriers and facilitators are defined through talking to people, re-engaging in the gray and scholarly literature. And as you are implementing, you are also monitoring knowledge use and uptake and figuring out how to sustain knowledge. So, of course, evaluation should be done as deliberately as all of the other steps in implementation, and it should be done early and often. Again, in an implementation science application, you are evaluating the implementation's theories, models, and tools and how they're working. So you begin thinking about it early, creating an evaluation plan and incorporating it into your implementation plan. Some people find it useful to use a program logic model. Other people identify evaluation questions, indicators, and outcomes. You can use an outcome measurement database to help inform your evaluation activities, and it's really helpful to use a developmental evaluation model. So an evaluation model that shifts according to how the implementation is going and the theories and models that you are incorporating as you go through the process. Many people have found the REAIM tool to be helpful in terms of evaluation. So now that you have a good understanding of implementation practice, we can move to implementation science. So as we said, implementation science is the study of methods, strategies, and processes that are designed to increase the uptake of research finding within a setting. So I think it's helpful to point out here that theory has been drastically underutilized and underspecified in implementation research. So for example, Proctor noted that in a review of 235 implementation studies, less than 25% of the studies employed theory in any way, and only 6% were explicitly theory-based. So this really compromises the science that can be done behind the practice. So while the success of implementation is the hoped-for outcome in implementation practice strategy, implementation science is the science that we need to be bolstering and promoting. So implementation science can address any aspect of the implementation, so including the factors affecting the application and distribution, the process of implementation themselves, and the outcome, the end products of the implementation framework under study, so how a proven intervention works in a different context, a comparison of different evidence-based strategies and theories of behavior change, and the processes behind scale-up of an intervention. So the biggest confusion is often between what an implementation science application is and what an implementation practice application is. So I thought I would go through a few examples of what are implementation science questions. So let's start at the top. A group wants to evaluate the most effective strategies to train new staff to effectively use the screening tools related to the role. The keywords here are most effective strategies. So you're not simply evaluating the practice outcomes of one specific strategies, but choosing between a few and evaluating those. The second question, so assessing what tool helps counselors, here you are testing a range of tools and choosing which one works as an implementation strategy. The third question, so the use of knowledge brokers. Knowledge brokers are an implementation strategy that you are evaluating, not how well it intervention works, but the role of the knowledge broker as an implementation strategy. And the fourth question, you're looking to an implementation science question around transferability. You're focusing on the CIFAR model of context analysis and adapting knowledge to that context. What needs to change? What can stay the same in order to promote fidelity? So I want to highlight this because I know this will be an issue as people start to write applications. An implementation science application is not an implementation of the intervention itself. So what were the practice outcomes? So we here at the Foundation love Proctor and her article done with colleagues around how to write an implementation science application. And we highly encourage you to read the article and to talk about it with all your friends on your spare time. So this slide is directly related to the competition to which this webinar is related, so how to write an implementation science application. So the 10 ingredients have been defined by Proctor et al. And should be included in any implementation science application. So first, of course, is establishing the care or quality gap, the clear evidence that a clear gap in evidence exists. This is sort of typical for any research program. And this, of course, is a result of knowledge synthesis and environmental scans, knowledge that's peer-reviewed, gray literature, and collected in the context of the proposed interventions. And number two is the evidence-based treatment to be implemented. So you have gone to the end of the knowledge funnel, and you have demonstrated evidence for the proposed services, program, or treatment that you are about to implement. So this is your evidence-based ideal practice. So and then we turn to the conceptual model and theoretical justification. So does the proposal delineate a clear conceptual framework, theory, model, or tool? In an implementation science application, we expect to see the inclusion of many theories and models and tools that inform the design and variables being tested. And very importantly, stakeholder priorities and engagement in charge. And this is in changing. Is there a clear process of engagement with stakeholders? And are all the stakeholders that should be included, included in authentically and meaningful ways? So this also means including a description of who will implement the ideal practice. So not only the people that will inform the development of it and do all that analysis around readiness for change, but also who will be involved in implementing this. And of course, the setting's readiness to adopt the new services. Is there clear information that reflects the setting's readiness and capacity and appetite for change? Is it ready? Is the time now? And of course, the implementation practice or strategy and process. Are the strategies to implement the interventions clearly defined and justified conceptually? And what is the team experience with the setting, treatment, and implementation process? Are all the people involved that need to be involved? And are these detailed appropriately? And the feasibility, of course, with the proposed research design according to funding, according to the timeline. Do the methods sections contain as much detail as possible, and are they laid out as possible choice junctures and contingencies should the methods not work as planned? And this really involves the flexibility that happens in an implementation project. It's a back and forth, the inclusion of new knowledge and where it's going to be included and who needs to be asked what. The measurement and analysis section clarifies the key constructs to be measured, which corresponds to the overarching conceptual model of theory. Is the measurement plan clear for each construct? And what is the policy and funding environment? So does the proposal address how the implementation initiative aligns with current policy trends? So is this setting ready? So that pretty much wraps up everything I had to say about implementation science and practice. And now we invite questions from anybody. Happening.